So I hand over the session to engineer Ankit Deep sir. Sir, please.
Okay, thank you, Santosh, for inviting me to address this gathering. I would say that utilities management, as they are the most important part of supporting any dairy operation, would be of a greater interest. So, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this session by me, myself, Ankit Deep, working as a scientist at Dairy Engineering Division at ICAR NDRI Karnal. Okay, so we come to this utilities. So, what do we mean by utilities as such? For dairy operations, we are having some basic categories for utilities. So, major utilities, we are having five of them: refrigeration, steam, electricity, water, compressed air. These are some of the utilities, and basically, utilities we mean is those services which are required for running of any processing plant, but they do not take part directly into the product formation. So, without the utilities, the plant or the machinery will not function as such. But we are required to have these utilities to make the machines or processing operations run. So basically, utilities, as the name suggests, are useful things, and they can incur significant running costs in dairy and food manufacturing. So they are essential. The essentiality will be becoming that we must optimize their operation so that the cost may be minimized. So, as I have already told you, these are five basic utilities, and these have been already placed in the order of their importance. So, if we see, the first comes refrigeration, then we are having this steam, then the third one is electricity, then water, and compressed air. Now, why I am saying that they are in the order of their importance is because in any dairy or food processing operation, as we are dealing with perishable products, the food products are perishable in nature, so we need to maintain a cold chain throughout the processing. So it starts from milking itself. So as soon as the milk comes out of the udder of an animal, then we must store it in a cold condition. Otherwise, it will start spoiling immediately, and it will keep on building up that bacterial count, and that spoilage will continue. So, what the refrigeration or processing plant will do is it will be maintaining a cold chain, and that cold chain will help to minimize the growth of bacteria and give us time for processing. And why this is most important? You have already understood. Now, coming on to the cost part, as this is the most important utility, and also because of its importance, it will be used very rigorously. And hence, the cost on refrigeration for a dairy processing plant is very significant. Basically, if we see overall bill, electric bill or energy bill of a dairy plant, then more than 50% of that comes from refrigeration system only. So that can also bring to our notice that refrigeration, how important it is to manage or maintain. Then coming on to the steam, because we know that in dairy and food processing operation, basically we are having two operations. Either we will be heating something or we will be cooling something. So we can heat and cool, and sequentially in a particular flow processing diagram, we need basic these two heat transfer processes. So after this refrigeration, next has to be steam, and for steam we need some boilers to run. Then electricity, basically for functioning of various processing machinery, we require electricity, obviously. Then water for various use, such as used as an ingredient, used for cleaning, used for other things like cooling of certain products or certain utilities like refrigerant, etc. Then compressed air for running of machines, automation, valves, etc. Now, taking up all five of them one by one. So, refrigeration, as you have already studied in your classes, that refrigeration, we need refrigerant to work on a refrigeration cycle. So, these are some of the photographs of refrigeration unit. So, here you can see there is this black part, this is compressor, this is air cooled force convection condenser, and we are having some pipelines connecting to them. So this is very some views. So at the back side, this is how it can look like, and from the front side in cross sectional view, we can see that how these different working parts are arranged. Now for refrigeration, we must first know that for running of a plant, for a calculation purpose, how much refrigeration capacity is required for a particular setup. For that, we need two technical terms. So one is ton of refrigeration, which is referring to the cooling capacity, and another one is coefficient of performance, which is referring to its efficiency. Ton of refrigeration means 1 ton of refrigeration capacity is that 1 ton of water at 0 degree Celsius should be converted into ice at 0 degree Celsius in 24 hours. So this is what we mean by 1 ton of refrigeration. And here 1 ton of water is British ton, which is not 1000 kg, but 908 kgs. So it comes around to be 3.517 kilowatts. So basically, ton of refrigeration is heat extraction rate. So in at a particular heat extraction rate, what is expected from the system? That is 1 ton of refrigeration. That is meant by ton of refrigeration. And you already have gone with several numericals in your studies regarding how to calculate that ton of refrigeration. So basically, this is cooling capacity of a compressor, which is the main working element. Now coming on to the COP or coefficient of performance. So this is efficiency of the system, and by efficiency, we require two things, output and input. For refrigeration system, output is the cooling and input is the electrical power which it requires to run. So whatever cooling is given by the system has to be divided by whatever power it is required to run that system. So if we divide these two things, we get a ratio, and that ratio is called as COP or coefficient of performance. And it has not been given a name of efficiency because it always comes out to be greater than 1 or greater than 100%, and we already know that efficiency cannot be greater than 100%. So why is it so is because in the case of refrigeration, the cooling is more than the electrical power which a refrigerator requires to run. Why is it so? You have already gone through in your refrigeration classes. So these are the four parts of refrigeration system. So here you can see that how they look like for a domestic refrigerator. So this is the compressor, this is condenser, so air cooled type condenser, which is not force convected or forced cool. This is expansion valve, capillary expansion type valve, and this is the evaporator, which is the deep freezer part, or ice cabinet part of the freezer. And these are how these four parts are connected in a cycle. So compressor, after the compressor there will be a condenser, where the condensation process of refrigerant will go on. So compressor will give high temperature, high pressure vapor form refrigerant, and by using this condenser, the refrigerant is condensed, so it converts into liquid form. So high pressure but near to ambient temperature, liquid form refrigerant will be there. Then it will go through this capillary tube, which is the expansion valve, and this dryer filter is an accessory or auxiliary equipment. Then this capillary valve, it reduces the pressure, so it converts that liquid refrigerant from high pressure to low pressure, so that it can gain some of the heat and immediately evaporate, because we know that by reducing pressure, the boiling point reduces. So in the evaporator, it will gain heat from the food products or from whatever is kept in that space, and then evaporate into low pressure, low temperature vapor refrigerant, and then it will go to the compressor to be compressed again into high temperature, high pressure vapor refrigerant, and cycle can continue. Now, according to the classification for method of compression, we are having three types: reciprocating, rotary centrifugal. According to number of stages, two types are there: single stage, multi stage, and according to location of prime mover, we are having these two types, which is open and hermetically sealed type of compressor. So these are working. That how this reciprocating is working, it is just like that IC engine. We are having a cylinder and a piston arrangement in which the refrigerant will be coming via a one-way valve into this cylinder, and via another one-way valve it will be exiting the cylinder after compression stroke has been done. In the rotary type, we are having these two different types shown to you here. This is a eccentric type, rotating impeller is there, which is capturing the refrigerant at one end and then compressing it and discharging at another end. And this is the screw compressor, in which we are having two counter rotating shafts with these plates, which are intermeshing together so that the refrigerant can be positively displaced from the suction end to the discharge end. This one is just like the centrifugal pump, and this is a centrifugal compressor in which the suction or eye hole will be connected to that evaporator side, and discharge port will be connected to the condenser side. According to the number of stage, we are having single stage, in which this cycle is one, or single cycle is there. In the multi stage, we can have in between a flash chamber. So there will be two evaporators. One of the evaporator will be called as a flash chamber, wherein we will be having some intercooling of refrigerant, because after compression the refrigerant will be heated up, and that heated up refrigerant, if it goes to second compressor, the heat will be too much, so that at the condenser it will not be able to be condensed. So in order to get it condensed, in between we need some intercooling. So that is the flash chamber. Now, according to the location of prime mover, we can have two types: open or hermetically sealed. In the case of open, the prime mover is different from the compressor. So we can see a motor which is separate from the compressor unit. In the case of hermetically sealed one, the motor and the compressor part is sealed together in one single unit. So that is hermetically sealed type. Now coming on to the condenser. Condenser, we are having these three basic types of condenser: air cooled, water cooled, and evaporative. So these are the two air cooled type, which I have already discussed with you. This is the free convection or natural convection type of condenser, which we could see in the older type of refrigerators. And this is the air cooled forced convection type of condensers, which you can see in the air conditioning units, outdoor units of split ACs. And this is the water cooled condenser, in which we can have a shell and tube type of heat exchanger. In the shell side, here you can see hot gas inlet, so the refrigerant will coming, high temperature, high pressure refrigerant will be coming in the shell side here, and then liquid line is at the bottom at the shell side only. So whatever refrigerant is coming in, that will condense and form a liquid level for the refrigerant, which will go from this liquid line to the next parts. In the tube side, we can have water. So here we can see condenser water inlet is there. So a number of tubes are there, and then in that this another side, we can see a U-turn will be there for water tubes, and water can come out at this side again, and hence cool the refrigerant on the shell side. This is evaporative condenser, in which we are having a combined effect of water and air cooled type category. So these coils, there will be refrigerant coming from the compressor, and on the top of it we can see these pipelines here. So these pipelines will be carrying the cold water, so that cold water will be sprinkled or sprayed over these tubes, so that these tubes can reject its heat to the water, and water will get evaporated. Some amount of water will get evaporated, rest of the amount of water will be in liquid form only. So the amount of water which will get evaporated will take its latent heat of evaporation from rest of the water which is in liquid form, and that liquid form water will get cooled and also heated. What it means is it will be heated by the refrigerant, but it will be cooled while falling down. So when that water is falling down, it will meet the air in this area, so that air will also promote the evaporation. So the water which was started evaporating at the top side will continue evaporating, and the water which is evaporating in this section will further lower down the temperature of liquid water which is falling down. So the water which has fell down will not be heated. So it will be cold water, it can be recirculated back. So what we can see here is water is cooling the refrigerant and water is being cooled by the air. And in both these cases, the cooling effect is by evaporation. So water is getting evaporated, refrigerant is getting liquefied in these tubes. So water will be recirculated because it is cold, and the water level will go down because it is getting evaporated, so amount of water will be required to be added back into the system. So that would be for making up the level, otherwise this tank will be emptied after some time. So it is just like the cooling of air in the room coolers, air coolers. This is another type in which we are having compact structure. So here we can see honeycomb structure is there, water can be sprinkled from top and air can be sucked from bottom. So at the top side we can see there is a fan, so this fan will be run by this motor. So this fan will be sucking the air from bottom to top, and while the air is coming from bottom to top, the water is falling from top to bottom. So it will be a counter flow type of arrangement in which the water will be evaporated into the air, and due to this evaporation of water, the water which is in liquid form and falling down will be cooled down. So it is like a cooling tower. So this is one more diagram, a cross section showing how this looks like and what are the parts. Now coming on to the expansion valve categories or types, we are having these three basic categories: capillary type, thermostatic type and float type. So this is capillary tube type of expansion valve, in which we are having a larger diameter pipeline connected to a smaller diameter pipeline. This is smaller diameter pipeline is known as capillary, and due to this reduction in diameter, we can have a reduction in pressure. By application of Bernoulli's theorem at this junction, we can see as the area is reducing while entering refrigerant is entering from larger diameter to smaller diameter, when the area of cross section is reducing, the velocity will increase, and when the velocity will increase, velocity head will increase, and due to increase in velocity head, pressure head should decrease, and that is why and how the pressure is reduced by this type of expansion valve. So it has no moving parts, so it has it is just a channel, it is just a pipeline of a smaller diameter. This is a thermostatic type of expansion valve in which the temperature is maintained. Thermostatic means thermo for temperature, static means for fixed. So if we are required to maintain the temperature of evaporator, then these type of expansion valves are generally used. Here we can see these two diagrams. These two diagrams are showing two different views or two different representation of same thing. So here we can see refrigerant which is coming here, this can go through this gap here. So there is a valve and a valve seat. So this is the valve which is located on this stem, and this gap in which this can sit into is the valve seat. So the gap between valve and valve seat, the refrigerant will go through. It goes into this tube. So this is the evaporator coil, and when it comes out of it, there is a feeler bulb attached to the exit of evaporator. So this feeler bulb is connected to the top of this valve again, and this top of valve has a diaphragm. So after this diaphragm to this feeler bulb, there is a temperature sensitive fluid. So when the temperature at the exit of evaporator falls down, this fluid will shrink in its volume, and this valve will get into its valve seat, and hence reducing or stopping the flow of refrigerant. And if this temperature at exit of evaporator is higher, then this feeler bulb, fluid in this feeler bulb will expand, this diaphragm will move down against the spring force, and we can have more flow of refrigerant. So what it will do is, it will maintain a constant temperature at exit of evaporator in any case by controlling the flow of refrigerant. So if the flow heat flow to the evaporator is more, yes, somebody has to say something. So if the flow of refrigerant is more, then more amount of heat can be extracted from evaporator. If the flow of refrigerant is less, then less amount of heat will be extracted. So the amount of heat extracted by the refrigerant will be matching or maintaining with the amount of heat available at the evaporator, and hence the temperature at the evaporator will not change. So the third type of expansion valve is flow type expansion valve. It is just like the overhead flow tanks which we have in our houses. So there is a needle valve in the liquid line. So liquid refrigerant which comes into this valve has a needle like of protrusion which is inserted into this liquid line. If there is a less liquid in this container, then this float will go down due to its buoyancy. Float will go down, and this needle will be ejected out of this liquid line. More refrigerant will enter. If the level of liquid is more, then float will go up and it will insert this needle into this liquid line and stop the refrigerant. So this type of expansion valve will be maintaining a constant level of refrigerant and not the constant temperature. So depending on the type of requirement, we can go for what type of expansion valve we require to have. Now coming on to the next part, which is evaporator, we are having two types of evaporator, flooded type and dry expansion type. In the case of flooded type, we have liquid filled into the evaporator tubes all along. So from starting till ending, there is only liquid. So as soon as there is any vapor bubble formed, it comes into this chamber by gravity, because vapors are lighter, they rise up and they will be rising up into this chamber, and that volume which is released by the vapor will be immediately replaced by the equivalent amount of liquid into the system, and hence the evaporator coils will be fully flooded with the liquid. So this type of evaporator will be fitted with the needle type of expansion valves and not with other types. This is the dry expansion type, in which we are having liquid refrigerant coming, and in the path, in the flow direction, when it goes away, it takes up its latent heat of evaporation from the food material or whatever material is there inside, and it vaporizes. So a liquid vapor mixture is there in between, and at the exit we can see superheated vapors are exiting. So liquid is coming in and vapors are going out. So this is dry expansion type, in which all liquid has been used up. So in this case, we can use thermostatic type of expansion valve, we can use capillary tube type of expansion valve. But in this flooded type case, we are required to use that needle type of expansion valves only. This is one more diagram for flooded type, and this is for that thermostatic. Now coming on to the application part. where this refrigeration is applied in the dairy and food industry. Basically, we are having a very important application, which is IBT or ice bank tank. So what basically ice bank tank is? Ice bank tank is a tank of water which is cooled so that ice forms or ice cold water is formed. Why do we need to do that is we are required to use that chilled water, ice cold water at other places in the processing lines for two different reasons. One of the reasons is wherever we require some cold water or chilled water, there we can supply that ice cold water. And other reason is for energy saving or optimization. Now covering both of them one by one, ice cold water is used or required to be supplied to say cooling section or chilling section of pasteurizer, say cooling or chilling jackets of some process vats or vessels. Say if you are having a cream tank in which aging is happening, there we require ice cold water in the cooling jacket. If we are having some processing line that requires lowering down of temperature to near to 0 degrees Celsius but in positive direction only, then we can use ice cold water and similar conditions. But what about that energy saving part which I told to you is that for dairy and food industries, for large processing plants where there is a very heavy requirement of electrical power for running of various processing machineries, there is a separate rate of electrical energy for daytime and nighttime. Because at daytime, what state electricity board do is they cater to the demand of electrical energy requirement to whole state for all offices, homes, industries, etc. And the electric grid which they have created throughout the state is designed in such a way that that demand can be catered to. But at the night time, when most of the offices are closed, almost all the offices are closed, the people move to their home, they go to sleep, and the electrical power requirement goes very down. It goes to very minimum. Then the utilization of that grid, which the state electricity board has invested into creating that infrastructure, is very much underutilized. So what state electricity board generally do is they provide a discounted rate, lesser electric power rate at the night time, so that the industries, factories, manufacturing, processing facilities, whosoever is interested for utilization of power. Just a second, please. For utilization of power will be having a requirement of electricity, or the electricity will be used at night time at lower rates, and that utilization of electric grid can be optimized. So what happens in dairy plants is they used to run the compressors of refrigeration plant at the night time, produce ice in the ice bank tank and store that electrical power into cooling effect of ice in the ice bank tank, so that at the daytime the compressors are not required to run for production of chilled water, and that ice can be melted slowly and supplied chilled water throughout the industry. So in that case, what happens is a chilled water pump here, as we can see, will be used to supply that cold water to the dairy plant, which was required with or without use of electrical power at night time. So overall, running cost of refrigeration plant reduces. As I have already told you, that more than 50% electric bill comes from refrigeration system, and hence that power saving or cost saving part at least can be done by using this ice tank. Are you getting this? So, are you still hearing me?
Yes, yes, sir. Your audio.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, for different cooling systems, what we require from refrigeration system is, these are some of the applications: sealed water tank and separate refrigeration unit. Basically, this is for bulk milk coolers, then immersion coolers, surface coolers, bulk milk coolers. As such, refrigerated storages are there. So, coming on to one by them one by one. So here you can see some of the equipments which we can get locally fabricated, because the dairy equipments are very costly, and some alternatives can be done. So this is a setup in which we can see that on farm cold storages can be used, cold cooling facilities can be created. So here we are having a insulated tank or a chamber in which we are having another tank wherein we are having water. So this water will be cooled by this condensing unit. So this is basically that VCRS, vapor compression refrigeration system. So that will be cooling this water, just like as in the case of IBT. We can have agitator to maintain uniform temperature and avoid forming ice on the walls, so that whole contents are at similar temperature, same temperature. We can place the milk cans inside, so that the milk in the milk cans can be stored at a lower temperature on farm itself. So what we can do is, we can get this type of system fabricated from the local fabricators, the fabricators who are fabricating those water cooling units. Water coolers are there from local fabricators, so they can be we can have this kind of system fabricated, so that a low cost unit can be there. In this case, we are not having any milk, any surfaces which are contacting milk, so we don't have that much of requirement regarding sanitary grade materials to be used. But then also, stainless steel will be recommended, because otherwise it will get corroded away and there will be much more problems. So at least this inside vessel should be stainless steel. Another thing we can go for is this immersion kind of cooler. Just like we have that immersion coils for heating the water in the bathrooms for bathing purposes and all, we can use immersion cooler for cooling purposes. So there is a refrigerant unit, but in the place of evaporator, we can form a coil like this, which can be inserted into milk can from the lid. So we can have a cooling coil fitted into the lid along with the agitator, because otherwise the milk will be frozen onto these coils, and these coils, because they are contacting the milk, has to be made up of stainless steel 304 only. So this can be also get locally fabricated. So there will be high pressure freon tubes, freon is for refrigerant, then agitator in between, and we can have double wall evaporator coils agitator, and it can be inserted into the milk cans, and then milk cans can be then covered for insulation from environment. So this is one more type of device which we can suggest for on farm cooling. Then one more device, which is surface cooler. So here we can see milk supply is coming, then there is a distribution trough. So there is a tray kind of structure in which we are having perforations at the bottom, so milk can get through these perforations, and it falls through this evaporator, evaporating cooling coil. So this is the refrigeration unit and this is the evaporator coil of this refrigeration unit, through which the milk is falling down. Milk while falling down will get cold, collected into this collection trough, and then it can go into milk cans, and then these milk cans can be insulated milk cans, or it can be covered with some suitable material so that the temperature does not go up again. Here also these evaporating coils are required to be made up of stainless steel only, and altogether this unit has to be covered for sanitary purposes. Then bulk milk coolers, which are already available in the market. This table is indicating one of the comparison between what is the project cost. Basically, if we see 2000 liter capacity bulk milk cooler and 5000 liter capacity bulk milk cooler along with the diesel generator set, DG set is diesel generator set. So here we can see project cost, it is approximately 7 lakhs in this case, 18.5 lakhs in this case. And these are for the profit and other economic ratios what we can have. So we are seeing that there is a economy of scales of operations. So if we go on to larger capacities, then there is more returns. So 43% internal rate of return is there in 5000 liters. So we need to go for some optimization. Basically, whether we will be able to procure that much amount of milk or not, that has to be seen first before going on to this procurement. Then refrigerated storages, you already know that these four different kind of storages can be there. So depending on what capacity is required and what is the application. So domestic refrigerator, then walk-in cooler, just like small cold storages, then deep freezers, which are used in shopping malls, shops, etc. And these are full-sized cold storages for various products. Now, these are some of the equipment. Basically, all of them are ice cream freezers, batch freezers, soft serve ice cream machine, continuous ice cream freezers, so which are requiring refrigeration for processing operations. Now, coming on to the next utility, which is boiler. Boiler is for steam generation. Basically, as we discussed in the case of refrigeration, here also we are having some technical terms. Basically, capacity of boiler is in terms of kg of steam per hour. So 1 ton boiler means 1000 kilograms of steam per hour, but that will not suffice just like this. We are also required to see other terminologies as well. So 1 ton boiler does not mean that this boiler has to store 1 ton of water in it. We can have a lesser quantity of water storage inside, but higher flow rates of water getting into the system and steam getting out of the system. So that will be regarding its volumetric capacity. So basically, if we are having capacity, water holding capacity above 25 liters, Indian Boiler Regulation Act is applicable and we are required to apply for a license of it. Boiler inspectors will be there, which will be periodically coming to check for operations, checking for renewal of licenses, etc. So depending on the type of boiler selected, whether it's water holding capacity, volumetric capacity, if it is less than 25 liters, there is no need for IBR certified boilers. And if it is more than 25 liters volumetric capacity, IBR certified boilers only are required to be used. In case of fuels, because we need some fuel to produce steam for heat transfer, so we can have oil fired, gas fired, coal fired, biomass or husk fired, as well as electrically operated boilers. So depending on which combination is having better returns, basically it will be a combination of capital cost as well as operating cost. It can be that boiler's capital cost is less, but its operation cost is more. So we need to see for it whether we are required to optimize only capital cost or only operating cost, or a mix of both. So basically, in general scenario, we go for mix, and in the case of mix, we allocate some percentage or weightage to both of these kind of cost. So fixed cost is capital cost, variable cost is that operational cost. Now, type of boiler, you already know water tube boilers in which water is in tube and fire is outside, and fire tube boilers in which fire is in tubes and water is outside. And this is a cut section of a fire tube boiler. Three pass horizontal fire tube boiler is there. So a main fire tube is there, then flue gases are exiting, coming into these tube bundles. Then once more they are getting out, and finally through the this exhaust stack that they can get out of the system. And in the shell side we will be having water, and that water will be forming the steam in this space, and from this space by using these pipelines we can get the steam out of the system. Now coming on to this very important diagram, basically in the refrigeration part this diagram I just skipped by mistake. So this is a load distribution diagram, steam load diagram. What it is telling is, it is telling that on the x-axis we are having time in 24 hours. So for a period of 24 hours, what is the capacity of steam required, and on the y-axis we are having this consumption. So here we are seeing at 1 a.m. so it is in the night, we are having this much capacity required, then at 2 a.m. like this. And here we are seeing at around 11 a.m. in the morning, this is the highest requirement of steam. So by plotting this graph, we can get an idea that what capacity of boiler is required to be purchased. So when we are planning for a setup of a business, dairy business basically, for processing of various dairy products, we require steam. And that steam requirement will be specifically different, or specifically we can say specific to the product, depending on the quantity, depending on its production rate, that at how much quantity per unit time we are producing some particular product. So if we make a schedule of operations, and then we plot a diagram, graph, so this will be a cumulative graph which will be showing that, say, at around 10 to 12 hours in the daytime, we are having most of the operations running simultaneously along with some of the systems in their cleaning or CIP stages. Then we are having a large amount of steam requirement at that particular time. So what this diagram is suggesting, it is suggesting say roughly around 360 kg per hour is the peak requirement of steam. So it suggests that we must go for buying or purchasing of a boiler which is able to supply at least 360 kg of steam per hour. But if we see that 360 kg of steam per hour is only applicable in this time period, but in rest of the time period, the boiler, if we purchase of this capacity, will be very much underutilized. So if we are purchasing a larger capacity boiler, it will cost more. Its running cost will be also more. If we purchase a smaller capacity boiler, it may cost less. Its running cost will be also less. So what we should do is, we should try to schedule the operations in such a way that this diagram is more or less horizontal. Means these peaks are lower down, and these places where the requirement of steam is low, we can shift some of the operations from these peak hours to those hours, so that almost throughout the day we are having similar kind of steam requirement. So that will bring down the overall capacity of boiler required to be purchased, and in addition to it, it will also optimize the utilization of the capacity of boiler as well. So we will be having two benefits from this diagram. One is rescheduling of activities in order to optimize the capacity required, and also we will be optimizing the equipment's capacity which will be purchased. One more additional advantage can be drawn from this diagram also, and that is that by getting an idea from this kind of diagram, we can go for purchase of more than one boiler. Means, suppose we are having an optimized requirement of 360, then we must not purchase a single boiler of 360 kg per hour capacity, but we must go for half capacity two boilers. Means, if 360 is required, we should purchase two boilers 180 kg per hour capacity each. Why so? It is because in case there is any issue, maintenance problem is there, some problem comes in the boiler and boiler cannot be operated, then in that case your whole operations will not get shut down. Otherwise, when boiler is shut down, whole processing operation will go shut down, but milk will not wait, milk will start spoiling. So there will be a huge loss. So to avoid that loss, what we can do is, we can purchase half capacity two equipments, so that if one of them is not working, we can still operate the plant at half capacity at least, and we can reschedule the activities to save on to some product, to save have some flexibility of operation. And it is always suggested that we must purchase three equipments of half capacity. Why three? Is because when one of the equipment will fail, then we are having one more equipment which is in standby or spare, so that whole operating capacity of plant is unaffected, and we can go for maintenance of that faulty equipment. But as an startup, as an entrepreneur, basically we do not have sufficient funds for purchase of these heavy machineries at the initial stages. Then what to do in that case? In that case, it is always suggested that we must draw this steam load kind of diagram for all utilities, refrigeration, steam, electricity, water, compressed air, all of them. And that diagram should be prepared keeping in mind next 5-year plan. And by keeping in mind that next 5-year plan, we must optimize this diagram and then purchase half capacity one equipment, all of the utilities equipment one set each, so that in the current scenario, when we are starting up our business, we will not be starting up in full fledged, we will be starting in phased manner. So in the phased manner, that capacity will not be half, but it will suffice the operation, and as soon as the cash flow is sufficient, we can go for purchase of additional equipments as and when it is permissible. So this is what is the utility of this kind of diagram. Now these are some of the equipments which require steam. So here we can see pasteurizers, evaporators, spray dryers, etc. And these are some of the estimates. So here we are seeing that gas oil fired IVR kind of boilers capacity 800 kg per hour with a maximum pressure of 10 kg per centimeter square will be costing around 20 lakhs. Electric non-IBR 100 kg per hour 5 kg per centimeter square pressure boilers will be costing around 1 lakh. So as an entrepreneur, we can start with this electric, but these prices are for capital equipment only, not for operational cost. In the operation cost side, electric boilers will be costlier because electricity will be having higher cost than these fuels. Now coming on to this another utility, which is electricity. Electricity basically we are required to calculate the load, as I have discussed with the steam side, that how much power is required for all the equipment. We are required to draw a shift schedule, and from that shift schedule we can then see which equipments will be running together, then what are their requirements, then adding all of them up, we will be seeing that what is the maximum requirement of electricity at a particular amount given point of time. So on the basis of that requirement, maximum requirement, we can then go for application of a connection from state electricity board, and we are also having these other consideration. So equipment selection, whether it is 220 volt single phase or 440 volts three phase, then should we go for generation of electricity or procurement of a connection, and a provision of diesel generator set for backup. Basically these three points, equipment selection, 220 volt single phase and 440 volt three phase, means that if we are having some machines which are running at 220 volts single phase supply and some machines 440 volt three phase supply, then we will be required to have both kind of connection. Basically three phase connection will be automatically having a provision of single phase connections in built, so that can be drawn from it. But basically this 440 volts machine are heavy machine and powerful ones, and for industrial purposes these are recommended, and hence we must go for them. And the rest of the machinery which are not so much power intensive, just like these computers, printers, etc., other office equipments, they can be catered to by using that three phase connection only, by suitable electrical connection diagram. Then generation or procurement, basically if we are having some energy source which is available to us, just like here we are seeing in the third picture, solar electric power plant. So we can have these solar panels installed at the roofs, at the walls facing the sun, and can generate at least a part of requirement which is which will be utilized for supplying of electrical power and reduce the overall cost of connection. We can also go for utilization of some waste going energy. Suppose we are having a lot of boilers, and those boilers are producing flue gases at very high temperatures. Those higher temperature flue gases can be used to run some engines, and those engines can generate electricity. So depending on what is the economics of that operation, we can go for self generation of electricity also. At Amul, Amul Fat Dairy Gandhi Nagar, we are having a captive power plant. They are generating their power themselves. They do not have a requirement of procurement. Although they are having a connection, but that is for backup. And this third point, diesel generator set for backup, this is for operation of some processing operations where we cannot have a failure of power. So in case power fails, then diesel generator sets are there. So those can be operated so that the operations can go on. This is again for that load diagram, which I have already explained to you in the steam case. Same applies to here. Now coming on to the water. Basically, water is used for these purposes: cleaning, washing, then soft water for boiler feed, potable water for ingredient for drinking and other things, then chilled water and hot water for processing operation. So we see to it whether the water which is available at site, can it be drawn from ground to groundwater, or is there any law governing in that area that we cannot dig ground for obtaining water, and there is some municipal water connection, then what amount of what capacity of connection is required? Then same load distribution diagram has to be drawn and then seen to it that what particular amount of water will be required. Now coming on to this final utility, which is compressed air. So compressed air, basically, as I have already told you, it is used to supply for various components of machine. Then pneumatic conveying means conveying by use of compressed air of products like milk powders. Then cooling and temperature control of machine parts, just like is in the case of pouch packing machine, that jaws, sealing jaws are required to be cooled, so they can be cooled by using compressed air. Then mixing of two fluids, just like two fluid nozzles in spray dryers. And these are some of the websites where we can go for estimates of the cost. So these were the five basic utilities in their order of importance and regarding some of the aspects for their management. So if you are having any questions or doubt, you may just ask.
Thank you, Ankit sir. Students, if you have any question, you can either post it in the chat box or you can unmute yourself and ask the question. Okay. I think there is no question from students. So thank you, Ankit sir, for delivering a beautiful presentation, starting from the basics of utilities and how to plan for or manage the utilities when you are starting for dairy plant. I think one question is there. Is there any scope? One question is there from Vishwajit. Is there any scope for using biodiesel in equipment?
Biodiesel in equipment, basically for boilers, is it meant for?
Yes, sir, yes.
So basically, biodiesel we can use. It will be depending on the compatibility of burner. So basically, we can go for two kind of equipments for this fuel. It can be boilers. It can be for that power generators. So if we are using that DG sets for generation of electricity, then that some of the coming up generators or coming up engines are having an option for using alternative fuels. Just like we are having hybrid engines in the cars, we can use different type of fuels. So based on availability of one type of fuel and another type of fuel. So similarly, depending on compatibility of burners. So there are some boilers with the compatible burners which can be used for gas fired, oil fired, and in the case of oil fired, we can go for petroleum based or just like this biodiesel based kind of things also. But from the cost point of view, the biomass or husk fired boilers are having lesser operational cost.
Thank you, sir. Any questions from the students? Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you for clearing the doubts of students.